Great to have our buddy Ian Castleberry joining us for our NFL Gold Nuggets feature presented by David Kreisman and DC Kreisman Jewelers. Ian Castleberry, great to have you in, buddy. How you doing?
I'm doing well. How about you guys?
We are. Man, and Eagles fans, we'll see if they're going to be doing well. They've got themselves a new head coach, and it's really a guy that most football fans have not heard of, but apparently Nick Sirianni comes highly recommended from Indianapolis, where he's been with Frank Reich since Frank Reich was in San Diego. He followed Frank Reich to Philadelphia, to Indianapolis. Now he goes back, and it seems to me like this is a hiring for Carson Wentz. What do you say, Ian?
Yeah, I think so. Colts offensive coordinator. The Colts were number 14 in passing. Phillip Rivers had a very good season for them. This past year also had a good rushing offense. Apparently it was between Nick Sirianni and Josh McDaniels, but I think you mentioned a key connection here in Nick Sirianni worked under Frank Reich. Doug Peterson was never as successful as Eagles head coach as when he had Frank Reich as his offensive coordinator. So if the Eagles can't hire Frank Reich, they can hire his right-hand man. And, I think they're looking at Nick Sirianni being able to work with Carson Wentz and improve him. Obviously, Phillip Rivers, a much different quarterback, a veteran quarterback. But I think they're hoping for that same level of success between Sirianni and Wentz as he had with Phillip Rivers.
Speaking of Phillip Rivers, yeah, Phillip retires, one of the best quarterbacks ever to play in a Super Bowl. But Ian, is that going to be his legacy? I hope not, because we talked about this yesterday. When you step back and look at the body of work, especially in 5 years when he's obviously a first-time inductee, first-time nominee, he will get into Canton. But I hope it's not that. But right now, I think folks are kind of focusing on it.
Yeah, this is something that often comes up, right? Did a guy win a Super Bowl championship? Should his career be entirely based, or the judgment and merit of his career be based on that? I think you look at Phillip Rivers as a whole. I mean, fifth all-time in passing yards, in touchdowns as well. He didn't make it to a Super Bowl, no. His second year, though, they did make it to the AFC Championship game, losing to the Patriots. I think, a 17-year career, again, the numbers stack up very well against his peers. Maybe he had a little bit of misfortune of playing in the same era as Tom Brady, Aaron Rodgers, Peyton Manning before that. So Phillip Rivers didn't get to that Super Bowl. But to me, he's a lock for the Hall of Fame. I had an argument with some coworkers about this, in that Phillip Rivers didn't immediately come across as a Hall of Famer when they were thinking about him. But
what?
To me, the Football Hall of Fame seems a little bit less strict and judgmental. Not to say that they let everybody in, because they don't. But
Steve Tasker still
Phillip Rivers, that's a Hall of Fame career.
Go ahead, Mikey. What
you say? Yeah, I agree totally. And you think about the way his career started when the Mannings, and I still never quite figured out why Eli Manning didn't want to go to San Diego. Just, they weren't that bad of a franchise and stuff. They had the problem with Leaf, but, they're pretty well run. And I know Manning won two Super Bowls, and the perception is Manning's a better quarterback, but the Giants won those two Super Bowls thanks to defense and just Eli being game manager. I know Eli's a good quarterback, but you can make a strong argument. Phillip Rivers was the better quarterback overall than Eli Manning and such. And like you point out, Tom Brady, he was around at some tough time and against some great, great quarterbacks, and he just never could quite. His teams just could never get through. They were pretty good there in San Diego. Then he had the weird move to Los Angeles and such, and then boy, he ends the career great with Indianapolis and having a great season in Indianapolis. So I just really think he's a Hall of Famer and just a great quarterback. And hey, all you have to look is Dan Fouts. Dan Fouts never went to a Super Bowl, but by God, he's in the Hall. I don't think no one argues that he should. Being a Hall of Fame.
That is what, are your colleagues smoking crack, Ian? Really? I mean, how could Phillip Rivers, he's like in the top six of every key category there. What was it?
I was surprised as well.
Wow.
To me, this is a no-brainer. But
what was it like, smoke weed for a day when you guys had that meeting? I mean, thank God you're there,
people,
buddy.
People were happy on Wednesday for various reasons.
Yeah, so, apparently maybe really happy on top of that. Ian Castleberry hanging with the wise guys on the DC Kreisman Jewelers Wise Lines. And, of course, Ian's appearance presented by David Kreisman and DC Kreisman Jewelers. All right, guys. Ian, your Lions hired a new coach, Dan Campbell. He's a big man. He's a very enthusiastic man. I wouldn't want to mess with him in a bar. Lately, for the last few years, assistant head coach, tight ends coach of the Saints. You know, a guy there from the Saints that I know people love is Pete Carmichael. But he's still with the Saints. Campbell on his way up to the Motor City. And he's been described as more of a motivator than an X's and O's guy. So maybe he'll bring in those X's and O's guys. But are you on board with this selection?
I am on board with this. I know I was kind of in the minority among Lions fans. I think maybe that perception has changed. Today, Campbell had his introductory press conference, and he definitely won the press conference with the media, saying all the right things about toughness and battling, and even showing some willingness to be innovative. That what would he learn from Sean Payton about, you know, doing what they do best and attacking what the opposition does worst. But you know, I kind of like the fact that he's not an offensive guru or a defensive guru, that maybe he can see the bigger picture of overseeing an entire team. He's not somebody that's going to have his face buried in a call sheet during the game because the offense is his baby, or, you know, treat his defensive linemen like they're his puppies. He sees the overall picture. You know, culture is probably an overused term in football these days, but I mean, man, the Lions really need somebody to come in there and be a leader and establish a mindset. Now, I know a lot of coaches say those sorts of things when they take over, and maybe this hire has Chris Spielman's stamp all over it. Chris Spielman now a special assistant to the team president, and I think he was really influential on this. But I'm excited about Dan Campbell. I do tend to get a little excited about head coaches, although I'll say I wasn't as excited about Matt Patricia or Jim Caldwell before him even. But I'm buying in. I'm on board with Dan Campbell.
All right. We'll see where it goes, Michael. He's an exciting guy. You know, Augie's always said, man, the head coach coaches the coaches. So if Dan Campbell can coach the coaches but bring in the right coaches, you know, who knows? We'll wait and see. It is the Lions. So, you know, we get excited for a minute and then go, well, let's just kind of pull back and see what happens. Ian knows what we're talking about here. By the way, Ian, Deshaun Watson, he's annoyed right now with Houston's brass for various reasons, basically not listening to him, you know, when it came to a head coaching search. We know the story about the general manager that they hired a search firm, did the Texans, and then the search firm gave two recommendations to minority candidates, and the Texans just said, that's nice, we're going with this guy. It's like, then why did you hire a search firm? And that was really upsetting to Deshaun Watson, who I don't blame being upset by. So now Richard Sherman's like, dude, you need to go to the Jets. Richard Sherman should never be a professional sports agent. He's horrible. That would be a bad decision. But could Deshaun Watson, and I've even said, hey, I like Teddy Bridgewater. I think give him another year to see what happens. But man, if you can get Deshaun Watson, you know, Panthers should go for that. Try anyway. And apparently teams are reaching out to the Texans. So what's the latest with Deshaun Watson? Does he stay or does he go?
I think he goes. I mean, if this becomes a disruptive influence, I mean, not to say that Deshaun Watson is going to go, you know, James Harden on the Houston Texans. And what's going on in Houston, by the way, with all their superstars wanting to leave. But, you know, this is just going to be the capital D distraction for the entire team. You know, when they report for minicamp, when they are in training camp, after every game, you know, if the Texans lose, you know, oh, what's Deshaun Watson thinking? I mean, I think making a trade is going to be difficult in that the Texans, and rightly so, should be asking for the moon for Deshaun Watson, and how many teams are going to be able to supply the draft capital. You mentioned the Panthers. And that's a great fit. I'm sure it would be hugely popular. Maybe Teddy Bridgewater would even be part of that deal going to Houston. But with what they would have to give up in draft picks, I mean, is that something that would, you know, really undercut the progress, the plan that Matt Rhule and the new general manager, I'm sorry, his name escapes me, but what plan they might have in place if they have to give up basically their entire future for Deshaun Watson? Reportedly, Watson wants to play for the Miami Dolphins, and maybe that's something that could be worked out. You know, maybe Tua going over to Houston, and they have the draft picks to get this done. But I do think this is a trade that's going to have to be made. I understand the Houston Texans don't want to give up Watson. They shouldn't. He's one of the best young quarterbacks in the NFL. But again, if this becomes a disruptive influence on the team, I think this is something that, you know, a new general manager, the new general manager, Nick Caserio, and a new coaching staff will just not want to put up with.
Mike Gore, I say, okay, I suggest Teddy Bridgewater in the deal, as Ian just mentioned. Christian McCaffrey, a first-round draft choice for next year and a second-round draft choice for next year. You're only giving up two draft picks. In 1 year, you're impacted. You're giving up your best running back, one of the best in the league, in Christian McCaffrey. But in return, you're getting a quarterback that is ready-made for superstardom, already there. The Panthers, I think, wide receiving core would benefit greatly with Deshaun Watson. Mike Davis has shown that he can carry a load when needed. It's a risk, but I think if the Panthers wanted to pull this off, I think they have the tools to do it. Combination of players and draft picks. What do you say, man? What's your thought on
this? Will Deshaun want to go to Carolina, though? You know, will he, you know, will just, no, I'm not going there. You know, it's, I don't know, because, what you say makes sense as far as that. Boy, it'd be tough to give up McCaffrey, though, and stuff. It'd be awful tough to give him up. Of course, he's had some injuries here the last year or two. But
Some guys don't always want to play for the hometown team either.
That's exactly right. And I just think if you're Houston, you've got to do everything you can do to make him. You've just got to do everything you can to try to get him in the fold. And maybe it's just a new coach, new general manager, just sit down with him for 2 days and just try to go over what we can do differently and stuff. And you just, not to bring up a name from a long past, but O.J. sometimes did this when he was with the Bills in the 70s and stuff, threatened to leave and wanted to be traded and stuff, and eventually just had to, you know, just hear him out. And eventually, you know, they kept him. And so hopefully – for Houston, they just got to find a way. I
can't see him. I mean, I could see him leaving, but at the end of the day, if you had to ask me, does he stay or does he go? I think Deshaun Watson stays, but management, Caserio, the new GM, he's got some work to do with Deshaun Watson. I just think smooth it over.
Everything you got to do is you got to make him happy somehow, some way.
Ian Castleberry playing with the Wise Guys on the DC Creaseman Jewelers Wise Lines. Pat Mahomes still in protocol. Ian, what's the status for Sunday? Do you think he's going to be a go?
I think he's going to be a go. I mean, I have a little bit of hesitation saying this. I got really mad. I don't know how you guys felt after Sunday's game, where Boomer Esiason, who apparently is a doctor now, saying, Patrick Mahomes is definitely going to play. I mean, he has no way of knowing that. Who knows? Each player has a different way of reacting to concussions. And by the way, we don't know if Patrick Mahomes actually was diagnosed with a concussion. But since he was put into the concussion protocol, he has to complete it. Based on what is happening this week with Mahomes going through practice, granted, practices at this point in the season are mostly walkthroughs more than, you know, hitting and so forth. But to me, him participating in practice says that he is farther along in the concussion protocol to the point where he should be ready for Sunday.
I got a guy that texted me, an old classmate of mine from the California days, and he's still under the impression that Mahomes isn't going to play. He keeps texting me going, so can the Chiefs still win Sunday? I'm like, dude, as long as Mahomes is there, I'm picking the Chiefs. So we'll wait and see on that, see where it goes. Good Lord. Like, leave me alone. Ian, the Steelers have made decisions regarding their coordinators. It's like the second text he sent me. All right, Keith Butler stays as defensive coordinator, but their offensive coordinator, names now slips my mind, is gone. And Ian, looking at Pittsburgh's struggles on offense, not a big surprise. Makes me wonder how much of Mike Tomlin's arm was kind of being twisted by management.
Yeah, possibly. Bringing back Keith Butler, I think, you know, the Steelers' defense was not their problem. They were number 3 against the pass, number 11 against the rush. But the offense, Randy Fickner was the offensive coordinator whose contract wasn't renewed. Steelers' offense was terrible, number 16 in passing, last DFL in the NFL in rushing, number 32. They got to improve that running game. James Conner is a free agent. I think they do have to bring in a new running back. They also let go of their offensive line coach, so clearly I think run blocking and that technique is going to be a priority in the offseason. All accounts are that Matt Canada, who's been an offensive coordinator both in college and the NFL, is going to be promoted to offensive coordinator. Steelers also interviewed Hugh Jackson, which is interesting. Jackson, you know, maybe he wasn't the most successful head coach, but he's been a very successful offensive coordinator with the Raiders, with the Bengals. And one more thing, I don't know if you guys saw this, the Steelers signed Dwayne Haskins to be a backup quarterback for 1 year. Ben Roethlisberger is only under contract for one more year. You know, if Haskins learns that system, he's still young enough where maybe he's the future at quarterback for the Pittsburgh Steelers.
Boy. Oh, geez, if I'm Pittsburgh, I'm still adding to that. I am not hanging my hat on Dwayne Haskins. Good Lord. But, hey, you know what? They could have him in camp. They can have him for a year and see where it goes for sure. But Mike Tomlin, you don't mess around. If this isn't working, Haskins is going to be.
Ask Antonio Brown. Ask
right.
Ask Le'Veon Bell. Boy, I bet Le'Veon Bell wouldn't mind being back in.
In Pittsburgh, absolutely. Although he's in Kansas City playing in the AFC Championship game.
Yeah, but he's a key player for him, but he's not the man like he was for the Steelers.
Exactly. Good point, Michael. And so we'll see where this one goes. Ian, any other Championship Sunday storylines coming our way? What do you got for us?
Mike mentioned Antonio Brown. He's a question for the Bucs. Is he going to play the Tampa Bay Buccaneers? They already have Chris Godwin and Mike Evans, but Antonio Brown, I think, received the most targets from Tom Brady over the past 5 weeks. So he's become a key part of that offense. Maybe a lot of other teams would miss Antonio Brown more, but you want all the weapons that you can have going into Green Bay against the Packers. Also, Vita Vea, a defensive lineman, one of their best defensive tackles, he might be available to play. And I think Aaron Rodgers and Ndamukong Suh have a bit of a history going back to Sue's days with Detroit. You might remember that Sue stepped on Aaron Rodgers' ankle. He stomped on the chest of one of the Packers' offensive linemen and was suspended for it a few years ago. I wonder if some of that rivalry will rear its ugly head in Sunday's game.
All right, we'll see where this one goes. Now we go for the big ones. Ian, we're going to get your championship game picks, beginning with the opening game on Sunday up at Lambeau, Bucks at Packers. Your pick and why?
I like Tampa Bay here. I mean, I know the weather could be a factor, but I think Tampa Bay is built for this. You know, they have Leonard Fournette. They have a good run-blocking line. They have depth at running back. I think Tampa Bay is just playing a really sharp on offense right now. And Green Bay can be shut down other than Davante Adams. I think their receiving corps is still a little bit shaky. And unless Aaron Jones has a great game, I think that run game can be controlled as well. I like Tampa Bay to win that.
Ooh, look at this, Michael. Go ahead.
You know, that Rams-Packers game was a lot closer than the final score indicated. It looked like the Packers were going to knock them out and never really did until the fourth quarter when Rodgers threw that touchdown pass and stuff. I just think the Bucs are on a roll and stuff. Now, they were sort of helped by the Saints' 4 turnovers in that game and stuff, and I don't think Aaron Rodgers is going to make those mistakes. So that'll be – I think it's going to be a great football game. I think it's going to be a great football game, and yep. I'll say Packers only because at home, but it's going to be 28-27 Packers by one.
Ooh, yeah, this is a tight one for sure. Are the Bills and Chiefs, is that going to be as tight to you, Ian?
I think it is, and of course, I mean, it's easy to say, is Patrick Mahomes – plays or not, you know, but if he does not play, I mean, I think the Bills are a prohibitive favorite in this. I mean, they could not only be missing Patrick Mahomes, but if they don't have Clyde Edwards-Hilaire, he practiced this week, but, you know, when they played, these two teams played earlier in the season, Edwards-Hilaire was a big impact in that game, probably the reason the Chiefs won that game. I think the Bills are going to win this game. And I'm not just saying this because I'm talking to Mike Gore here, but I don't think the Chiefs, to me, they've kind of played down to their competition all year. And I think it's a little bit hard to turn it on. And we saw that a little bit against Cleveland. Mm. Obviously, if Mahomes doesn't play, that's a significant factor. But I think the Bills' defense can control the Chiefs' offense, especially if Mahomes doesn't play enough. And Josh Allen, he could be the difference in this game, especially with his legs. I wish the Bills had a stronger running game going into this.
All of us wish the Bills had a stronger rushing game.
But Josh Allen is their best running back. I mean, I think he's going to be the difference in this game. I think the Bills are going to win this game.
All right, we got 60 seconds. We're up against the clock. Mike Gore, Ian's teed it up nicely for you. What do you say?
Buffalo 28, Kansas City 21.
Ooh, man, that's with Mahomes.
That's with Mahomes.
Okay. Look, you're right. Cleveland, that Cleveland game gave me a little pause with Kansas City.
They didn't put him away. They didn't put him away. They're 19-3. When Mahomes was there, they had that game. You know, they said they had to suffer some field goals, and then the Browns get that terrible break on the touchdown that fall. You know that that they should have had fumble. Stuff in the fumble and out of the end zone, the terrible break there. It took a gutsy call, fourth and one. I mean, anyway, so.
Michigan man Chad Henne, too. I mean,
That's right. I forgot to congratulate your people on that because he did well enough to secure the win. But it's going to be a great game. It'll be the final game of.
But if Chad Henne plays, it'll be a good game. I mean, don't think the Bills are going to win by three touchdowns if Chad Henne plays. Now, that guy's been around a long time.
No way.
We will see. Guys, thanks so much. Ian Castleberry, you're the best, my friend. Enjoy the weekend.
Okay, I can't wait, guys. Take care.
Likewise. Thanks, Ian, very much. Ian Castleberry with the Wise Guys, presented by David Kreisman and DC Kreisman Jewelers.